Welcome to worship today. I'm Pastor Jeremy. We're here at our Suntree Campus Chapel to have the atmosphere that we're worshiping with you in your home. There's a few things that you need to prepare for to fully participate with us in worship. The first is a songbook that you can download at our website at adventbrevard.org. The second thing is we'll be celebrating Holy Communion together. So if you'd like to do that with us, we ask you to get out your best wine glass and fill it up with wine or grape juice and some type of bread that you can use as well. And you can place that by you as we worship. You can go ahead and pause the video if you need to prepare for that and come back and we will continue to worship through song.
Traced out by sea lights, the sudden stop. Breathe in the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. See a girl in our eyes meet. Does the best to smile at me to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right, black suit and a bright red tie. Too ashamed to tell his wife he's out of work, he's buying time. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah.
So for our family activity, if you are worshiping together as a family and there's kids in the room, talk to the kids for just a second. This may be surprising to you, but your parents or the adults that are with you right now are not perfect.
What?
Did you know that? And parents or adults, this probably is not a surprise to you, but your kids are not perfect. And maybe you're worshiping with just your spouse. Again, your spouse are not perfect. And if you just have to be worshiping by yourself, you're not off the hook. Hate to tell you this, you're not perfect. None of us are perfect. But the good news is, even though we're not perfect, Jesus died for us and Jesus loves us. One of our scripture verses from Romans tells us that Jesus loves us so much that he died for each and every one of us, and for the whole world. And we're so grateful for that gift that God gives us through his Son and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So for our family activity, I want you to take turns going around to each person, and everyone gets a turn to do this. I want you to say to each other, kids to the parents to the kids, adults to adults, or if you're by yourself, I'll say it for you. But that even though you are not perfect, that Jesus loves you and Jesus died for you. And then make the sign of the cross on their forehead. So I'll go ahead and do that. Even though you are not perfect, Jesus loves you and Jesus died for you. You can go ahead and pause the video and do that, and come on back for our readings. Our first reading is from Romans chapter 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into his grace, which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because our hearts, by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. You see, at just the right time, when you were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Here ends the reading.
Healing rain is coming down. It's coming nearer to this old town. Rich and poor, the weak and strong, it's bringing mercy, it won't be long. Healing rain, it's coming down, it's coming closer to the lost and found. Tears of joy, tears of shame, I'll wash forever in Jesus' name. And healing rain, it comes with fire, so let it fall and take us high.
So let it fall and take us.
Our Holy Gospel starts in Matthew, the 9th chapter. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like a sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." He called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits, to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Do not go among the Gentiles or into any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, preach this message: the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out the demons. Freely you received, freely give." This is the gospel of our Lord. If you are worshiping with us on Sunday, June 14th, it is Flag Day, which commemorates in 1777, our getting our national flag. That's why we have Flag Day. And because of Flag Day, this week there's been a lot of documentaries going around on TV and streaming services. And I happened to be watching one of these documentaries about World War I. And it actually was about right after World War I. Someone collected all these interviews and written interviews from people all over the world, and there had one thing in common. Almost every single person believed that this was the war to end all wars. And they believed that the generations coming after them would learn from this violence and the wickedness and the death that happened and would never repeat it again. In fact, they're written letter after letter, interview after interview of people who said that the Treaty of Versailles was going to have lasting world peace for years and years to come. Well, I don't think I have to tell anybody, but here we are decades later, still searching. The world is still searching for that peace. In fact, it didn't last that long at all. Well, peace is what our Romans text talks about today, and this is a text that's very familiar to us Lutheran Christians. It's one that Luther loved and talked about all the time. But it's not the kind of world peace that we think about. The peace that talks about in Romans is really the peace between us and God. Now, we're sinful, like I said in my family activity, that we are imperfect, we are sinful. Sin separates us from God. We are not right with God because of our sin, and there's nothing we can do. Nothing we can do. We are helpless to get us closer to God. But luckily, Paul tells us there's something God did. And I want you to hear these words again. "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." We're justified through faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, because Jesus loved us so much and died for us and rose again, we do have peace with God. And this is not the earthly peace. This is a peace that's outside us. This is a peace that reconciles us back with God. And it's a free gift that God gives us. Our salvation has been taken care of. Our salvation is secure. What a wonderful and amazing gift. Now, many Christians like to stop there because that's such great news, especially us Lutheran Christians. We love to stop there to hold that dear, wonderful salvation that we have, an unconditional love that we have and grace that we have from God, and just kind of stop there and just bask in God's grace and salvation. But it doesn't stop there. We're called to be followers of Jesus Christ. So what does that look like? Well, that looks like our gospel passage today. It looks like those very first apostles and very first Christians and what they sent out to do. And again, I want to read these words again. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. And when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ever since Pentecost a few weeks ago, we have been talking about what God calls us to be as followers of Jesus Christ. We've been given Jesus' commands to go, to make disciples, to love each other, to treat each other as Christ treats us. And here we have Jesus telling us that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. There's so many parallels as we keep on reading these stories of these first apostles, these first disciples, these first Christians as they became the body of Christ together, these very first followers of Christ, and what's happening right now, today, in 2020. It is so true that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So we need to figure out God's mission, which we know through the scriptures and what we've been talking about, to go make disciples, to be the best followers of Jesus we can be. We need to figure out, what does that mean for us? What does that mean for Advent Lutheran Church in 2020 during this pandemic and after? Well, I think it's a lot of the stuff that we've been talking about for quite a while. But I think it's time that the talking turns to action. Because we like and want to stay in that grace, in that salvation, in that mercy, and we love it so much, it's so hard for us to move out of that. And sometimes we're even afraid to move out of that, because if we do good things and we do what God calls us to do, we're afraid that God might think we're doing that to gain our salvation, but that's already been taken care of. So here's how I see us moving forward as God's people at Advent Lutheran Church, in our homes, in our faith community, in our neighborhoods, in our town, in our state, and in our nation. We're going to be focusing on five main things. The first one is discipleship, which we've been talking about already, as Pastor Dave talked about last week. Everything we do is going to be rooted around becoming better disciples of Jesus. How are we going to connect to Jesus in better ways? And how are we going to make disciples of others? Secondly, we're going to have life-changing, transforming worship. Worship is a time for us to get together, to get energized, to hear and listen to the Holy Spirit, to receive God's forgiveness and love through the sacraments, and then we are sent out to do God's work. We're going to focus on faith formation from birth to death. No matter what age you are, we're going to give you resources and ways to be connected to God and connected to each other, especially our youth, our children, and our young families, to walk side by side each other. And we also need the experience and the knowledge and wisdom of those who have already done it. Every generation coming together and learning from each other. We are going to learn what it means to truly do outreach, to evangelize, to learn to share our faith story with each other, learn to share our faith with each other and with strangers. We're going to partner with our ministry partners and do the good that Jesus calls us to do in the world. And we're going to engage our community. Our community is going to know that Advent Lutheran Church is a place that people can come, that they're going to be welcomed no matter who you are and where you come from. You are welcomed here, and this will be a safe place to have those hard, difficult conversations that we need to have as people of faith, to be a safe place to share our opinions. And we're going to treat each other, even in these hard discussions, with grace and respect in Christ-like ways. Now, the expectation, if you call yourself a member or a friend of Advent Lutheran Church, if you call Advent Lutheran Church your faith community, the expectation is that you are going to be involved in each of these five things somehow, some way. Now, I know that's a big expectation. It's a God-sized expectation, but that is what it's going to take to be the church and to bring God's peace to this world. It's going to take each and every single one of us. Now, I know you might be listening to this sermon, and maybe you're a youth, maybe you're a young adult, and you're thinking to yourself, well, you know, I got my whole life ahead of me to worry about that. I'll do it later. I really need to focus on myself now and focus on my needs. Well, the church needs you. Maybe you're married with young kids or a little bit older kids, and it's everything you have just to get through the day. Even in this pandemic, you seem to be busier than ever, and you just busy and schedules and activities. And, you know, maybe I can give you 1 hour on a Sunday or Saturday for worship, but I just don't have enough time. The church needs you. Maybe you're retired, and your whole life you've been told that follow the American dream, and if you just work hard enough and save enough money, then you can move to Florida and retire and do whatever you want. Besides, you have been faithful followers of Jesus. You've done all this before. It's time for someone else to do it. The church needs you. It's truly going to take each and every one of us. And we are so blessed. We're so blessed that our salvation has already been secured. Our salvation's already been taken care of. But it's time. It's time to stop taking our salvation for granted. And it's time to start moving. The harvest is plentiful. Are you ready to answer God's call to be one of the few? Amen.
Welcome to the planet. Welcome to existence. Everyone's here. Everyone's here. Everybody's watching you now. Everybody waits for you now. What happens next? What happens next? I dare you to move. Dare you.
Let us pray together. Oh, good and gracious God, we ask you to just fill us with your Holy Spirit, to fill your whole church, all churches everywhere, with your Spirit, that we can see that this is a new time, a time of reformation, a time of change, a time to truly be the best followers of Jesus Christ that we can be. Help us to not take our salvation for granted, but let us be the eyes and ears and legs and mouth and everything of Christ for this world. We pray that we can take what we learn from the scriptures and those very first apostles, those very first disciples, and be on fire for the Lord to spread the good news. Help us and guide us and lead us to do your mission in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our towns, in our state, our country, and the world. Lord, we continue to pray for this world that is decimated by violence and hatred and evil. We pray that your peace that passes human understanding may guard the hearts and minds of those who you created, your children. We pray that we could come together to see past our differences, to overcome our human sinfulness, and to come together as your creation. Be with all those leaders who are making tough decisions. We just pray, Lord, for unity and love and peace and mercy to rule over all. Lord, we continue to pray for this pandemic, for this virus that we seem to know so much about, but know hardly anything about. We pray that you give us, our sciences and scientists, the ability to figure out a vaccine and treatments and be with all those who are suffering from this virus and all diseases everywhere, and be with those who are taking care of them and loved ones. You know who they are, and you know what their needs are, and you promise to hear our prayers as we bring them to you. So, Lord, we do that now. We bring all, we pray for all those we lift up to you now, either out loud or silently in our hearts. Catherine's dad. We pray that your will be done in the lives that we pray for. We pray that your will be done in our lives as well. Lord, we just pray that we listen to your voice. We pray that we have the courage to do the things that you command us to do. Help us be your church. Help us be the body of Christ together. All these prayers we lift up to you, trusting in your mercy through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, we will share Holy Communion together. So if you don't have your communion elements ready and by you, now is the time to do so. Each time we gather as God's people, we do remember that we receive God's love and forgiveness through, and one of the ways we do that is through this holy meal. And we remember that in the night our Lord was betrayed, he had a final meal with his closest disciples. And at that meal, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. He gave it to his friends to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new promise I give to you, poured out by my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's pray together the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As you commune each other, give the bread and say, "Body of Christ given for you," or "the wine and grape juice, blood of Christ shed for you." But no, these are God's gifts for us, God's children. All who are hungry and thirsty, come eat and drink. The table is set, and you are welcome. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
Amen. Blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you. It's the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
This is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. The body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. As we prepare for our in-person worship that's going to be starting on the weekend of July 4th and 5th, we have sent out a very important survey to see who's planning on coming and worshiping with us and what services and where. This is going to help us be able to plan and prepare for the social distancing that needs to happen. That survey was sent out on the weekly email. If you don't receive the weekly emails and you want that survey, you can contact our pastor's assistant, Linda Herman, and we can get that survey to you. Even though we will have in-person worship starting July 4th and 5th, we will continue to videotape those services and have those available for those who still would like to stay home and worship from home. We continue to have our Bible studies, one on Sunday morning, one on Tuesday night, and one on Wednesday night. Also, Pastor Dave and Lori have been putting out our evening prayer that's been posted on Wednesday nights at 7:30, and I've been also doing morning devotions every morning at 8. All those can be found at our website, adventbrevard.org, website and YouTube channels. Again, thank you so much for your giving. As we continue to get ready for in-person worship and other ministries, we've been keeping our expenses down as much as we can, but ministry is going to be in full swing here really soon. So any giving that you can give right now would be greatly appreciated to our general budget. Again, you can send in your offering to our Suntree campus or go online and to find out how to give online. Thank you again for your generosity. Now receive God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you God's peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Today is the day you have made.
truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I'll live for you.
All my days I'll live for you.
And I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I'll live for you.
All my days I'll live.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. Sorrows, where you lead me, I will follow, trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day.
We are followers of Jesus Christ for the sake of the world. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God, and we will.
1, 2, 3.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it.